shameful as it is obvious. We will not borrow. That is what the MPP always say. The MPP throughout the 2016 campaign claimed that it will not borrow when it comes to power. We noted that this claim was not possible because even when MPP in 2001 became the biggest beneficiary of debt forgiveness in our history by taking the country to HIPIC, it went on borrowing spree and became before the NPP left office in January 2009. The debt to GDP ratio had gone up to nearly 40% as a result of excessive borrowing by the NPP after the debt were very much forgiven. So we in the NDC knew that the claim by the MPP when it will not, saying that it will not borrow was a great deception, which most people have failed to realize. The MPP added another record in borrowing. In less than 100 days of being in office, the MPP has exceeded this notorious feat and deception again. The MPP now holds another new record in our history, as the party has borrowed almost over $300 billion, $3 billion.
Fastest so far.
Within 800 days in office. This is the world record. This is equivalent to about 13.5 billion in 100 days, averaging about 135 million cedis a day.
Oh.
Or in other words, every Ghanaian owns additional, within the 100 days, every Ghanaian owns additional 500 Ghana cedis.
Oh.
Indeed, now that we know the party is in great hurry, for the wrong deception reason, even Usain Bolt, with the world 100 meters global sprint record, and Lewis Hamilton, Formula One race champion, will be envious of such speed and record. Ladies and gentlemen, you will recall that in 2015, the MPP criticized the NDC heavily for borrowing approximately $1 billion at a coupon rate of 10.75% for 15 years, with the World Bank guarantee to replace a portion of 2007 NPP sovereign bond and the domestic bonds. The key point about this recent 2.25 billion bond that has very much so been described as Templeton Enterprise Group bond. The bond was virtually participated by only two investors. The whole bond transaction was shrouded in secrecy to the extent that Ghanaian investors were denied opportunity to participate in the deal.
Oh.
In essence, the entire deal lacks transparency. One single investor by name Franklin Templeton, which is a known non-resident investor, everybody knows him, investor that patronized both domestic and sovereign bonds in the past, purchased almost 95% of the latest government domestic bond. The size of this is virtual private plus air placement, makes it akin to sovereign bond or foreign loan. Some have argued that this bond purchase should not be compared with our sovereign bond rates. We would be reminded that our domestic bonds have a hybrid, the Cedi and the Forex feature. And therefore, when non-resident investors bring in foreign currency at the time of purchase, they hold the equivalent Cedi bond in the same explicit, implicit foreign exchange, foreign currency. Therefore, when the eventual sale, they expect to repatriate the proceeds in the US dollar or other convertible currencies. Hence, the above 95% bond withholding that Templeton is holding is technically a dollar-denominated bond and not a Cedi bond. Let me very much remind all of us that the bond will be serviced in Cedi, but very much so, since the participant is non-resident, they'll be repatriating their profit, being the interest in dollar. At any point in time when they decide to sell, they will be selling at the secondary market. Take the money in Cedi, the Bank of Ghana will have to guarantee them a Cedi rate, and they'll be repatriating very much so in a convertible currency, in this case, US dollars. The Ministry of Finance and Bank of Ghana are alert to the risk of default in non-resident investor holding and plan to support a commercial bank or agent with enough foreign exchange to honor any sale and repatriation obligations at maturity or in the secondary market. In essence, the opposite sales activity for non-resident bond holding in the opposite of a purchase, foreign inflows, and implies depletion of our foreign reserves, as we all talk about. It is very much so a deception when you hear the Vice President saying that they borrowed, and for that matter, the reserve position has increased. I wish to challenge the Vice President and tell you that, Mr. Vice President, if this participant, Franklin Templeton, today decide to leave the Ghanaian market by selling at the secondary market, your reserve position will decline. So it's not sustainable, it's not the way to go. So Vice President, revise your note. This is why the domestic bond issue must be efficient. On the contrary, the virtual private placement approach that was used in this Templeton case was not competitive. It was open to the morning, it was open in the morning and closed in the evening.
One day.
On the same day. Obviously cooked for single investor. So this was very much cooked for one single investor. Hence our insistence that there was no transparency. In the past, the book building approach for the issuance of bond initiated by the then NDC government, Honorable Satepe, the process was open for a minimum of 3 days to ensure optimal participation. In the case of this historic 2.25 billion bond, the process was limited to 1 day, denying other market players the opportunity to participate in the process. Surprisingly, only 2 investors take part. And I'm sure we all know Franklin Templeton by now, and we all know another company by name, State Street, also took part in a very small margin, less than 5%. We in the NDC cannot promise the good people, we in the NDC can promise the good people of Ghana that we will continue to keep track on the government, on the country's debt development, and hold the NPP government for its fake promise and deception that brought it to power. The Ministry of Finance statement unmasks the secret of the said bond. So ladies and gentlemen, I entreat you to listen carefully. On Monday, April 3rd, 2017, the Public Relations Unit of the Ministry of Finance issued a statement announcing that the ministry under the aegis of the Honorable Ken Oforiatta has successfully issued a 15- and 7-year bond with the same coupon rate of 19.75. The way the yield curve is drafted, one would think that the one with a longer date would actually would very much so yield a lower coupon. For us to lock in a rate of 19.75 for 15 years is bizarre. Raising a total amount of 1.13 billion in addition, the Ministry of Finance raised the CD equivalent of 1.2 billion in a 5- and 10-year bond via a TAP arrangement. And for the purposes of our friends here, TAP arrangement is when you have an existing bond and somebody decide to buy into an existing bond by giving you the same rate. But the question we ask is that, at that time, what was the inflation rate? At that point, at that time, what was the monetary policy rate? So why was the government in hurry? The Ministry of Finance did not, however, name any company or individual that participated in the sale, except to say that the issuance attracted a number of global portfolio investors, including a very substantial investment in the 15-year bond by a very well-respected global financial investor. So let me say that the issue did not attract a lot of investors. It was cooked for one investor.
Yes.
Reuters subsequently reported that a senior government official, speaking on condition of anonymity, said Franklin Templeton had participated in the sale. According to the report, Franklin Templeton, high-profile bond fund manager, Dr. Michael Hessentab, has taken a substantial position in Ghana City-denominated government bonds. Franklin Templeton Investment Limited is an American global investment management organization founded in 1947. In an unaudited financial semi-annual report of Franklin Templeton Investment Limited, dated 31st December 2016, you can find it on the internet, Honorable Trevor Jean Travgen was named as one of the 5 board of directors of the firm. He was also described as the chairman of the Enterprise Group Limited in the report. Enterprise Group Limited has 10 board of directors. Principal among them was Mr. Kelly Gajepo, Group Chief Executive of Enterprise Group. Dr. Angela Ofori-Atta, who is the wife of the Finance Minister, Honorable Ken Ofori-Atta. Who doubles? Who doubles? Can I take that again?
Yes.
Because Trevor happens to be a board member of Templeton, and we checked, and straight away after checking, you notice that under their unaudited financial statement, it has an address that leads to Ghana. Surprisingly, we noticed that that address is a company called Enterprise Group. So we decided to find out who are the directors of Enterprise Group. So listen to me, who are the directors? The Enterprise Group has 10 board of directors. Principal among them is Mr. Kelly Gajepo, Group Chief Executive of Enterprise Group. Dr. Angela Ofori-Atta, wife of the finance minister. Honorable Ken Ofori-Atta, who doubles as director of Enterprise Insurance, a subsidiary of Enterprise Group. Enterprise Group also have the Minister of Justice and Attorney General, Honorable Gloria Ekufu, and Dr. Angela Ofori-Atta as non-executive directors of the firm. Honorable Gloria Ekufu was director of the Enterprise Life, a subsidiary of Enterprise Group. It is not clear whether she has resigned or not. It is now emerging that the firm that Trevor, Honorable Trevor J. Travgan, is a board member in, worked as a, which we, that participated on April 3rd, 2017 bond that was issued by his good friend, Honorable Finance Minister. Ladies and gentlemen, as noted, the information is now available in the public domain. Appears to indicate that Honorable Trevor J. Travgan is not just a board chairman of Enterprise Insurance Limited, a company owned partially by the current finance minister, and his company, Data Bank Limited. In fact, for the purposes of the record, Data Bank owns Enterprise Group as at 31st December 2015 when we checked. They own the bank, Enterprise Group, by 39.6%. It's conflict of interest. So I want to take you into the conflict of interest situation. Honorable Trevor J. Travgan is also a director of Franklin Templeton, which is the main participant in the recent bond issue. Putting this apparent fact together, we have reason to believe that there was a relational interest between our finance minister and his good friend, Trevor J. Travgan, which creates a potential lack of transparency and a conflict of interest. As we all know, the Constitution of this Republic provides unequivocally that the public officer should not put themselves in a situation in which their private interest conflict with their public obligation. There is no record available to us to the effect that the finance minister made known publicly his relational interest. That conflict very much so in the interest in his company with Trevor J. Travgan, and the extent to which the relation might have potentially affected the decision to sell majority of the bonds to Franklin Templeton. Furthermore, there is no disclosure as to the extent to which the determination of the price of the bond could also have been affected by the relationship between the finance minister and his friends, Franklin Templeton. Now that a good link has been established between the finance minister and his friend, Trevor, it is clear that the finance minister issued this bond in a way that will favor his friend, family, and business partners. This situation is best described as cronyism and nepotism at its highest level, cooked for his friend and his associate, and not transparent. Under these circumstances, we wish to call for a full-scale parliamentary inquiry into this transaction, whether and to the extent to which this situation of lack of transparency and conflict of interest have adversely affected the welfare of the people of Ghana and the interest of the state. Failing such parliamentary inquiry, we in the minority shall have no option but to resort to the using of the conflict of interest jurisdiction of the Commission on Human Rights and Administrative Justice, SHRAJ. Furthermore, we also intend to exercise the option of filing a report petition with the Financial Services Authority, popularly called the Ombudsman in the US, to investigate Franklin Templeton of participating in a bond that is not transparent. We also wish to point out that this bond issue is clearly an international economic business transaction within the meaning of Article 1815 of the Constitution. Therefore, we expect that the bond issuance would have been brought to Parliament for approval. This is because although the transaction appears as to be a domestic sale of the bonds, it is in truth a private placement and an international economic transaction given the fact that Franklin Templeton is a United States registered company and therefore qualifies as a foreign entity under Article 1815 of the Constitution. We therefore call the Finance Minister to provide Parliament with the full complement of the documentation on this transaction for scrutiny, the terms and condition, the Public Financial Management Act, stipulate what should be sent to Parliament, and we demand them for scrutiny and possible ratification. It is not strange that we are seeing this conflict of interest situation. Ladies and gentlemen of the press, we heard the Honorable Minister of Information, Honorable Mustafa Hamid, who has come to confirm to the public that the Addison Committee that was tasked to investigate Ameri Power Purchase Agreement traveled to Dubai under the sponsorship of the Ameri. The information available to the public now is that some members of the committee traveled to Dubai on a first class ticket. Via Emirates Airline 787. They were hosted at a first class hotel. Their per diem were paid by Mary. They were given some shopping money, which was fully paid. What comes to us as a shock is that they were supposed to be there for 3 days, but they decided to extend it by a week. For a reason that is best known. Strangely, the minister's brother, the Minister of Energy's brother, who is also a member of Parliament for Ayawaso West Wagon, my good friend Emmanuel Ejakun, is reported to have joined the trip. To have joined the trip on the second day, slept in the same hotel, treated the same as a member of the committee, and for that matter, that his expenses were fully paid by Ameri. It is reported. We in the minority demand full disclosure of this information. Also, it is undoubtedly true that Addison Committee is a ministerial committee and therefore a public body. This committee was duly inaugurated by the Minister of Energy. The committee was under the constitutional obligation not to place itself in a situation of conflict of interest. However, as stated above, the committee brazenly breached this constitutional obligation when it accepted the above freebies, gift, and hospitality that can be seen more or less as material. They failed to disclose the intent better known to them. However, as stated above, I've mentioned that already, given the public embarrassment of allowing the private entity to bear the full cost of the work of the committee or public body, the constitution breaches must be properly investigated and the guilty members of the committee should be appropriately sanctioned. Ladies and gentlemen, we in the minority think that the way that this bond was very much so structured, was structured in hurry, wasn't transparent. We don't believe Ghanaians had value for money. Clearly, you see the linkages between the finance minister and his friend. We've seen the linkages between the finance minister and his friend's company, of which the finance minister has the largest, his company, Delta Bank, has the largest share in Enterprise Group. We are saddened to say that clearly there's a complete conflict of interest issue. There's a clear relational interest between the finance minister and his friend. His friend very much so owns or is a director of Franklin Templeton. We ask Ghanaians to be with us. Our pledge to you is that we will provide you credible opposition, credible minority. We will guard the public pass to make sure Ghanaians get value for money in everything we do. That is our pledge to you as fellow Ghanaians. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.